Hey everyone, I'm Kirby, this is Kirby Meets Audio, and we've come to the end. This is step six of our six-step process to design a speaker. We're gonna do some final measurements today. It's a little bittersweet. All right, so let's take it back a bit. We started this process out by planning our build. We wrote our goals and constraints list and decided on an enclosure and crossover type. For this project, we went with a ported enclosure and a two-way crossover. We next chose our drivers and we ended up with the Dayton Audio TCP 115 woofers and the TD20F tweeter. Both are very budget friendly and are pretty easy to work with. I'll link those down in the description if you wanna check them out and get more info. We then designed our enclosure using WinISD and our crossover using the FRD and ZMA files provided by Dayton using the VitUX design software. Those are both free software and you can download them through the links in the description. Everything's down below, you know what's up. We finally built our enclosure out of half-inch MDF and used solid birch for our front baffle. I made some pretty detailed videos about all these steps. You can go watch them right up there if you're interested. So the closure I came up with for this project is okay. After building it, I think I'm gonna make a few changes. Mostly I want to add a front-facing port and widen the enclosure just a little bit, maybe like a half inch or so. I'll be designing that over on Instagram, so go check that out. All right, so we have version one of our speakers finished. With our crossover, we designed using the manufacturer's measurements, but those measurements aren't specific to our enclosure, and the enclosure you have your drivers in does impact the measurements, the sound, quite a bit. So we're gonna do two things. First, we're gonna measure our speakers with a crossover we've designed and compare it to what we were hoping for. If those look good, then awesome. We may have to make some small tweaks, but we're pretty much done. But I don't think it's gonna be quite that easy. I didn't do any baffle diffraction models when designing, other than leaving like a 5 dB bump at the bottom end of our frequency graph. So I'm expecting to have to do a little crossover reworking, but we'll see. If that is the case, we're then gonna take the crossover off, get raw measurements of the drivers themselves, so we can make our own FRD files for these drivers specifically in this enclosure, load those up into VitUX and make our changes from there. So you might be asking yourself what the heck we're doing outside. Well, the enemy of a test like this is reflections off of hard surfaces around the speaker. These reflections combine with sound coming straight out of the speaker to your ear and either increase or decrease the amplitude or volume of certain frequencies, depending on how far away the reflections are coming from. The best way to measure a speaker without reflections is in an anechoic chamber. Those are one of those rooms with big foam spikes on the walls. Those spikes absorb sound waves, so when you're in one, your ear only hears the sound coming from the source itself. It's actually really strange to stand in one. You're so accustomed to hearing lots of reflections in everyday life that when those go away, it feels like you have big muffles on your ears or something. It's almost like there's pressure on your head. It's really strange, but it's cool. So I don't have an anechoic chamber yet. They're expensive and take up a lot of room. But to get good measurements, we don't need a perfect reflectionless environment. We actually just need about 6 feet of separation from our speaker and anything else hard around it. That keeps our measurements from about 50 hertz and up pretty clean. So the best thing you can do is actually go outside, lift your speaker and your mic up about 6 feet into the air, make sure we're 6 feet away from any trees or structures, and take our measurements. Okay, so the next question I would ask is, why is this important? Why don't we just set these speakers up in the room they're gonna end up in, take measurements there? I mean, they're gonna end up in that room anyways. Well, you can do that, and people do that sometimes. But taking measurements in a specific room, then designing your crossover based on those measurements optimizes those speakers for that room and that room only. If you were to move those speakers to a different room, you can run into some really big problems. The idea with taking measurements in an anechoic environment is that it sets your speakers at a baseline that should sound good or as good as they can in as many different rooms as possible. And since these are intended to be a kit, we want broad usability. All right, let's take a look at what we got. All right, so this is the response graph we got. It actually looks really good. I'm surprised. I didn't think it was gonna end up this good. You can see we got a little dip. We got some little craziness right here, just under 1K. But in our plot, you can see this is just under 1K. We got a little wonkiness right here before our big bump. So we kind of expected that, but it's pretty nice. It's not bad. All right, so the only other thing I see is also down here around our base response is that we weren't quite getting down to the 50 hertz we were looking for. Now, our setup, I was hoping to get clean measurements down to about 50 hertz. It looks like we probably didn't get that, but we did measure just under 100 hertz with a pretty quick die off. Not great, but I did measure the actual port, and that looked really good. Like, it looked solid. It was in same amplitude range as the rest of the frequency graph, which is another reason why I want to add the front-facing port. I think that'll really help our bass response in listening situations. It'll also help our bump and our baffle diffraction. So other than that, from what I know, I think these look pretty good. I don't think there's much more I can do to this, or I want to do to this, other than some enclosure design changes, but we talked about that. As far as my impressions with these speakers in an actual room, I'm really happy with the sound. With how much they cost, budget in mind, it's kind of crazy. I don't think you could find a better value for a speaker build than these guys. I'm not trying to like toot. It's less me. It's more like the actual drivers themselves. I'm not trying to like toot my horn here, but they do. They sound really big. The imaging is nice and wide and deep. The high is sparkle without being too overwhelming. I think they came out good. I'm really happy with what we came up here together. All right, so if you're interested in building a pair of speakers of your own, head over to kmakits.com where you can find free build plans and complete kits for purchase. If you're new here and you like this video, please hit that subscription button, then hit that little bell if you wanna get updates on when I post videos. I also have a Patreon where fans like you help me make videos like this one. If you wanna see the behind the scenes of making these videos, or my speaker building, or just my life in general, hit me up on Instagram. There's links down in the description, or I guess search Kirby Meets Audio. That's it. All right, that's it. It's the end of this series. So I'm gonna keep doing this though. I'm gonna pick another project and then we'll do another 6 to 8 videos on building that one. It'll be different. So I think the next one's gonna be a home theater soundbar subwoofer project for a buddy of mine. It's gonna be good. I've already started designing it. I'm excited. All right, until then, see ya. See ya later on this week. 2 videos a week. 2 videos a week. All right, see you guys.